post-match chat with Chapz for that Millwall podcast, where it finished at the Den. Millwall 1, Birmingham City 0. What a difference a goal makes. Honestly, what a difference a goal makes. 4-point buffer now between us and Birmingham. A 4-point buffer between us and the relegation zone. 3 wins, 1 draw, 10 points in 4 games. We are third in the form table in the league. And also, it changes your whole perspective on the game, doesn't it? I think, let's be honest, after about 89 minutes, you probably think to yourself, all right, a point's not the end of the world. You know, clean sheet, maintain an unbeaten record for Harris. But, you know, it's all ifs, buts and maybes. You start to possibly question when substitutions were or weren't made. You know, we were better in the first half. They were better in the second half. But that goal just changes everything. And it's massive. Make no mistake about it. That goal is worth Tanganga's wages for the whole season. That goal is huge. We now go to Leeds next week full of confidence and no reason not to be. And Harris talked about that in his post-match, and that's why he's absolutely the right man to take us to Leeds. You know exactly what it's going to be like and what sort of prospect facing Leeds at Elland Road is going to be like. But look, let's go through the game. You know, it was just I honestly haven't felt that happy coming home from a game at Millwall for a lot. I can't remember the last time. Honestly, the way in which we won, that is Millwall, isn't it? Let's be honest. A game against a side with a bit of rivalry. I think 17,000 there yesterday. Decent atmosphere for most of it. On Jimmy's day as well, which was always you know, great to see the Mizzen family down there. And then that last 10 minutes, we after a really disappointing second half performance, I think, from us, considering how well we played in the first half, we just came into our own. The likes of Leonard and Saville really grew in leadership, I felt. We're going to talk about that. And we just found a way to get that goal. We used the crowd with the set pieces. We forced, you know, no coincidence that 3 out of our 4 corners all came towards the end of the game. We got the job done. And that's all that matters at the minute. But honestly, I've not felt as happy walking away from the Den as I did yesterday for a long, long time. And I've seen a few people tweet it and post it on Hoff, so I'm not going to try and claim it to be my own. But if you could bottle that feeling, it was just fantastic. It really, really was to you know, spend time with friends and family and, you know, my old man that's taken me since I was a boy. It was just fantastic yesterday, that feeling walking away from the game. But anyway, look, 3 minutes in and we need to get cracking. So let's talk about the lineup then. So quite a few changes. First one, obviously, Imaku. I expected him to come out anyway, but I didn't realise it'd be coming out of the side due to injuries. It sounds like he's out for a month now. So that's Imaku, Bradshaw and Nisbet out for, you know, for at least a month. So we're going to have to go with what we've got. And that meant some changes. So I was surprised, if I'm honest, to see George Saville start in the middle of the park. I felt he looked leggy against Blackburn. So I was surprised by that. I was also surprised to see Danny Mack dropped. I felt that whilst he obviously made the error for the goal, I felt that Danny Mack had played quite well overall. Shows what I know, because Joe Bryan was fantastic yesterday. But look, I'm talking about how I felt before the game. So the lineup was Sarkic in goal, back four, right to left of Ryan Leonard, continuing at right back, Tanganga and Jake Cooper, centre halves, and then Joe Bryan, as I say, coming in on the left-hand side. Saville and Mitchell still in the centre of the park. Honeyman on the right. He then brings Duncan Watmore back in on the left-hand side. And then Obafemi returns to the starting lineup after getting his first goal in a Lions shirt Tuesday at Blackburn with Fleming just behind him. So that was our 11. For Birmingham, I think Birmingham are a good side on paper. I really do. They've got some very good players. They really have. And you only look at their bench, and we'll talk more about some of the changes that they were able to make. And some of the players they didn't even bring on, the likes of Dembele, for example. I know he's been out of form, but Birmingham have got some good players. And I've always liked Tony Mowbray. I know he's not well at the minute, and Mark Venus is stepping in. I wish Tony Mowbray well. But Birmingham, to their credit, they're an organised side. Personally, I think they'll have more than enough to stay up. You know, I genuinely believe that. And they gave it a go. There's no denying that. They didn't come to sit back and not try and win the game. So it was a very even game. I think we maybe just shaded it in terms of actual chances created, but we're going to go through those now. So I think, again, you know, we start with the same kind of tempo that we have been at home for some time under Harris now. For our first chance comes on 10 minutes where on the right-hand side, George Honeyman wins the ball back after losing it, does really well, plays a nice combo with Duncan Watmore, and then gets in on goal. And John Ruddy does very well, actually comes out and smothers the ball really, really well. That was a good opportunity. Our second opportunity again comes. So good work from Ryan Leonard, wins the corner. The corner comes in, finds its way to Cooper, who with his right leg, I think he just sort of swings a foot here. And it's a very good save from John Ruddy down low to his right-hand side. Not really known, John Ruddy, for his acrobatics in this day and age. He certainly is known for coming and claiming crosses because he did that all game long, with the exception for one, which we will talk about. But he did well. We had another chance where, and it's just, this is the thing, it's not attractive football, but, and we do play a lot of percentage football. We play balls into the channels, we play balls over the top, but we create chances from it. We create chances against Watford, and we create a chance here that, you know, the ball goes over the top, confusion between the back line and their goalkeeper, and Duncan Watmore manages to head it over the on-rushing John Ruddy, but just can't quite get enough and direct it in towards the goal. But we really did create opportunities in the first half with the intensity, forcing errors by pressing and long balls. That's not to say they didn't have their chances. They had a couple. I think they got in on goal once in the first half, which was some good work by Pake in the midfield, who I quite like the look of. Again, another decent player. Finds Jay Stansfield, again, another good player on loan, I think, from Fulham. From a tight angle, good shot. Sarkic does well. And then also have a long-range effort from Alex Pritchard. And as much as we all hate him down there, we know what he's capable of. And another decent player at this level, getting back to fitness. And then we have half-time. And I had my usual half-time pint and spoke to a few people and really felt it was a big second half. Because I thought we actually played quite well in the first half. I thought Obafemi, the stats won't show it because he didn't have chances and whatever. But up against a very physical defender, Mark Roberts, I thought Obafemi, we sort of seemed to just pelt balls into him. And he did really well to hold the ball up and control it and bring others into play. I thought Obafemi, for his off-the-ball work and his link-up play yesterday, was probably his sort of best 45 minutes of football. I feel like he's really starting to find his feet, and obviously had to complete, you know, I don't know if he went off right at the end. I think he might have done for Hutch or something. You know, he basically completed 90 minutes, which he will need to do probably again on Tuesday. You know, I really felt the second half was key, and it was going to be decided by a goal. You know, both sides, not a lot of goals in it. But I felt we won the first half. We just didn't have that goal to show for it. It was probably our best passage of play, I would imagine, under Harris. You know, I think, you know, we weren't very good against Blackburn and Watford, and Southampton was very backs to the wall stuff. So yeah, I think it was probably our best half of football under Harris. And it was like, okay, what would the second half bring? Well, the second half was a complete opposite for the majority of it. Particularly up until 60 minutes, Birmingham, probably more than 60 minutes, Birmingham dominated the second half, and they got into some really good positions. Two chances I've noted down here. Bazuna plays for Southampton. Bakuna, again, I've always liked him. Bakuna, a player that, whenever he's played against us, has looked dangerous. Takes a free kick. Initially, you're thinking, what is he doing? He sort of plays a short ball to Pritchard. He then eventually gets it back, and he manages to get to the byline, bring the pass the ball again, get my words out, goes through the box. And then it finds itself to Stansfield. And Billy Mitchell here, watch it back. Billy Mitchell makes a goal. I'm telling you, it's a goal. If he doesn't make that block for Stansfield's first effort, was the best chance of the game. It is superb work from Billy Mitchell. And then between Mitchell and Honeyman, we put enough pressure on Stansfield so he puts their second chance wide. That is the best chance of the game by far up to this point. And Birmingham really probably should have scored there. And it was superb work, it must be said, from Billy Mitchell to stop that. They have another, no chances created, but the amount between sort of 50 and 60 minutes, the amount of times they managed to get the ball across the face of our goal, but just they couldn't seem to find, a clear opening. It was the first time, other than against Southampton, that I felt they had the beating of us, particularly down Leonard's side. I'm not saying Leonard played badly because he didn't, but they did manage to get down that side a few times and cut balls across. They also then have another chance where ball is played in, Stansfield's played in again after some good work. Was it Miyoshi? I can't remember who, but some good work and Stansfield's kind of threw on goal, but Tango, we're going to talk about him. I absolutely love the bloke. He does really well just to force Stansfield wide, and then Stansfield shot goes high and wide. But it's good defensive work from Tanganga because, make no mistake about it, I don't think other centre-halves would have been quick enough to push him wide and then obviously make the kind of attempted tackle that forces him wide. So it's another decent chance. We then have a good chance on, I think it was 64, where, again, just throw-in. It's a throw-in. Fleming throws it into the box. Then Cooper flicks it on. And then Saville, he can't get over it enough. This is the problem. It's a half-decent effort, but he just can't get over the ball enough. And it goes over the bar. That was our best chance of the second half. And again, from a territorial perspective, Birmingham continued to dominate. But then I felt we really started to come into our own. And when I actually felt that change was, incidentally, when they made a very attacking substitution. So what they did was, they took off Pritchard, as I say, is coming back to fitness, and Sunjic. So, you know, sort of two midfielders, if you like. And then they brought on Jukovic, as they did against Hull, and obviously went on to score the equaliser. And Jordan James, who, again, you've got to look at Birmingham's bench, right? Now, Birmingham are below us in the table, right? But the players they have, and Birmingham fans listen to this, you may not think so. And I know you always think about other teams and resources and stuff like that. But we don't have another striker on the bench at all. We did not have another central striker. Obafemi had to play the whole 90 minutes. On the bench, they've got Jordan James. They've got Lukas Jukovic. They've got Hall. They've got Dembele, who didn't even get on the pitch, who, all right, I know he's going for a dodgy patch of form, but he's a very good player. And he's, for the first half of the season, he was Birmingham's best player, in my opinion, and also one of the better, certainly from an output perspective, one of the best players in the Championship. Tyler Roberts didn't even get on, who started the game against Hull. So they've got options, right? Gardner, you know, decent player at this level. Ethan Laird was great for QPR. So they've got lots of options, Birmingham. So this is what we're up against. And before I talk about our goal, you know, Harris alluded to this in his post-match, that we are having to manage a lot of these players, right? I hear all sorts of various rumours and, you know, God knows where any of this is true, but I think it might be, given some of the words that Harris used. There are players, and I'm assuming Leonard is one of them, that can't train every day. Because if they do, they probably can't go out on the pitch and perform for 90 minutes. And this is what I think people need to realise. We are not that good. we really, really are not that good. We have a few players that are technically decent, two of which actually were on the bench yesterday. You would argue that Brooke and Denor are probably two out of our three best technically players. Probably you got up there, Zian Fleming and Joe Bryan. But other than that, we're not that good. We're just a team full of honest, hard workers and grafters and defensive forwards that will put a shift in. Whereas other teams do have more quality, but we're finding ways to win. And Harris knows, this is why I said from day one, he's the perfect man for the job. He knows, out of the players that he knows, which is why the likes of Brooke and Denora are not getting a look at it at the minute, he knows how to make them effective and win games of football. And that's exactly what he's doing. But let's talk about the goal then. So I felt the last 10 minutes, I think they made those changes on 83. We started to come into our own. We started to get more of the ball in their half. We started to, win the odd corner. Again, more pressure. The crowd start to come into their own. And this is where Harris is brilliant. He knows how to use those situations. You know, it's no surprise that yet again, our goal comes from a set piece. We've had three goal scorers. So Harris has scored 5 goals, right, since he's been with us. 3 goal scorers. Obafemi, Tanganga's got 2, and Fleming's got 2. That again shows you just how important those 3 individuals are. But we've only scored 1 from open play, right? But this corner, so Saville wins the corner. Fleming does really, really well down the left-hand side, takes on the man, puts the ball across the box. Saville comes onto it, hits it, shoots, deflected wide. The crowd then lifts. Everyone gets up for it. And Saville's delivery was brilliant. They weren't, our corners were poor up till this point. Every ball we seemed to put in the box, John Ruddy would come and claim. But as soon as I saw that ball go in and John Ruddy not come, I knew we had a chance if we could make a decent connection, because they're not the biggest side at the back, other than Mark Roberts, who's a unit. They're not the biggest side at the back. And I actually listened to a Birmingham pre-match and they talked about how they felt set pieces could be the downfall because of their size. And Tanganga's unmarked. Tanganga is unmarked. And it is a fantastic header. He gets up. You've got to bear in mind that these players are knackered at this point, right? But he gets up, leaps like a salmon, bottom corner, and then the den just erupts. It was just that moment. Honestly, I cannot tell you how good that feeling is. I mean, I'm sure if you're listening to this, you know exactly how good that feeling was. To score in there, I don't know if it was 89th or 90 minute. It was just fantastic. It was just fantastic. And then I tell you what was equally fantastic was what Saville and Leonard did in injury time. So before that, Harris makes a couple of subs, freshens it up. Good to see Hutch back on the pitch. He goes to 3 at the back. Hutch does make a vital interception as well, so it's good to see him back in there. You know he's going to marshal the team for those couple of minutes. But Saville and Leonard in particular, the ball is cleared to the right-hand side, and then there is a 50-50 moment where I can't remember who it was up against. Was it Bakuna? I can't remember. But Leonard, you can see him. He sees... And one of the things that Leonard's very quick off the mark, but you've got to bear in mind, this is 92nd minute. He's played 3 90 minutes in a week, but he just goes for it. He just sprints everything he's got to get to that ball first, knowing if he does that, he wins as a free kick, and that's probably enough. He gets there just ahead of the player. You see him smack the ground in celebration. I just absolutely love to see it. Again, the crowd erupts. And then what does Saville do with a free kick? He just levers it. I think he's aiming for the corner so the ball goes out of the ground. Just such shithousery. Absolutely love it. We see the game out, 1-0, rocking all over the world is playing. And it's just, I'll say, just the difference that goal makes is just unbelievable. We go from questioning why Denora hasn't started and Norton Cuffey's not coming earlier and when SA is going to get a minute to Neil Harris has done it again. You know, we're 3rd in the form table with the last 4 games. 4 games, 10 points. I remember saying that Harris has not had a new manager bounce where he's not got at least 7 points from 4 games. Well, he's surpassed that and he's got 10 now. It was just absolutely fantastic. It really, really was. And again, you know, I think some of our leaders coming on strong, Tanganga getting up when it mattered. 4-point buffer now. Huddersfield are playing at the moment. Let's see how they're getting on. But it was just a huge goal for us. It really, really was. Huddersfield are winning. That's not what you want, is it? Come on, West Brom. Jed, remember, where you were born, my friend. Right. So a couple of things I wanted to go over. So I wanted to highlight that I was concerned. Let me take a step back for a second. I was concerned after the Blackburn game because we were poor, so were Blackburn. But I felt that even with the Harris way of playing, we weren't being effective. And I talked about the fact we only had 8 touches in the final third, the whole game, which was our lowest for some time. And I was concerned by that. So I'm just going to flick something up now on screen. So for those of you listening to this on a podcast, what this is this is not touches in the final third. I managed to find touches in the penalty box. And by the way, the reason I'm showing this is because I don't care how you get to the penalty box. So a lot is made of Harris going route one or whatever. I don't really care, but it's very difficult to score many goals when you're not having touches in the penalty box. So that, to me, don't care what happens before it. I care about getting into positions where we're going to score goals. And yeah, all right, you can score goals from outside the penalty area. Of course you can, but it's unlikely, right? It's not as likely as touches in the penalty box. So as you can see on screen, that away at Blackburn, we only had 7 touches in the penalty box. And that's where my concern come from. But yesterday against Birmingham, we had 25 touches in the penalty box, which is why, again, on the eye, it just looked a better performance, particularly that first half. It was our highest touches in the penalty box for the last 10 games. Obviously, Borough before that, 28, which, if you recall, we were very unlucky to lose 3-1 at home. First 30 minutes against Borough, we were fantastic. But I wanted to show this because I did feel yesterday overall the performance was better. And I wanted a way of showing how, personally, I said from day one, I don't care what the football's like. I don't care if all we do is just pump balls into the box. But we have to touch the football in the penalty area to score goals. And we did that yesterday. So I think that's a positive trend that I wanted to sort of share. I think Harris has an effective way of playing to our strengths. What are our strengths? Well, our strengths are we've got a side that, when motivated, will give absolutely everything and will just literally put their bodies on the line, which I think, again, they did yesterday. So I think that's one of our strengths. Another strength is set pieces and dead ball situations. So whether that is throw-ins, corners, free kicks, using... Whether we aim for Cooper or not, he just causes confusion. So again, being able to utilise that, I think, is important. And then at home, the den. And Gary Rowett never found a way of utilising that, let's be honest. And Joe Edwards didn't. But Harris is basically saying, right, you've got hard work inside, not that much quality. We're good from set pieces and we've got the den. How do I leverage all those three things to be effective? And he is carrying out that plan at the minute superbly. And that is why I honestly could not give a monkey's how the ball gets into those areas as long as it gets into those areas. So I wanted to share that. The other thing, I just want to talk a little bit about Birmingham and how I felt they're a decent side. They came to try and get some points. There's no denying of it. They didn't shut up shop. They didn't, you know, try and just play for a 0-0. I personally don't think. They're not a bad side, and how we nullified them was, again, just sheer graft. So flicking on screen again, and I've talked about this before. So this is defensive actions against Birmingham. So again, for those of you looking on the podcast, I've taken a look at their last 6 games. So Blackburn, Sunderland, Ipswich, Southampton, Hull, and then us. Another thing I found quite interesting is, other than Sunderland, we've played all these teams recently as well. So we played very similar teams. But you can see here clearly, we had 99 defensive actions versus an average of around 70 before that. So we nullified Birmingham by just stopping and playing. More tackles, clearances, blocks, interceptions. So I don't think Birmingham are a bad side. It's just that we just worked very hard in trying to nullify them. So I thought that was important because, again, it just shows you how hard we worked. That has been consistent since Harris has come back into the club. Another thing that I found really interesting as well, just another stat, I'm not going to put on Instagram, I'm just going to say it, is Since Harris has been manager, teams have only been caught offside twice. And I think what also that shows is we are playing a much deeper defensive line. So if you're playing a deeper defensive line, yet you're inviting pressure, but we're comfortable with the ball in front of us. We're not comfortable with the ball behind us. You know, getting Jake Cooper to turn and run that way is just not very good. And the higher line you play, that's going to what's going to happen. I think that's where Joe Edwards fell short. So the fact we're only having, you know, twice in four games offside, again, I think shows how Harris has deployed a very different defensive line. So I wanted to sort of share those couple of things. Now I'm going to sort of do player ratings and analysis. I'm not going to go through every single player, but I don't think, other than maybe Duncan Watmore, anyone had a bad game. I thought actually everyone put a shift in and played pretty well. I was worried about the likes of Savon Honeyman. Could they sustain, you know, 90 minutes of effort levels? And they certainly did. In terms of man of the match, it's really difficult this week. Joe Bryan got the official one. And if I'm honest, I'd probably give him joint man of the match, to be honest. Joe Bryan, he actually completed 16% of all defensive actions. So again, it just shows you that he was vital in stopping them. So I think that was justified. And I thought he was quite a threat going forward. So to me, he did justify his starting position yesterday. Cooper, not man of the match, but I thought it was an improved performance from him. He had his highest pass completion and pass progress stats since Preston at home, which was some time ago. You know, I felt that his passing and distribution was far better than it has been. So I just wanted to give that a call out because factually it was his best from a passing and a progress perspective, best performance under Harris and since the Preston game. I thought Honeyman was good again, worked his absolute socks off. And actually I felt he was more effective going forwards than he has been. Usually he's been very effective going the other way, but I felt he was actually effective going forwards and I thought he was pretty good. I thought Obafemi worked very hard and did very well in terms of, as I said, around his hold-up play and just causing teams problems. Fleming was okay, worked hard. I don't think it was his best game. I thought Savile and Leonard had games that they grew into. You know, I think Leonard was beaten a few times, which is rare for him. But again, the last 10 minutes, somehow Savile and Leonard found a way to just grow into that. And I think they were vital in getting us over the line. But my other joint man of the match is Jaffet Tanganga. Before, again, he scored the goal, but his defensive work was fantastic once more. The problem I've got with Tango is I'm really, really starting to like him. And I know there's a recency bias, but personally, I think he's a better player than Daniel Ballard and Charlie Cresswell. And we've been here before where we sign a defender, a centre-half on loan, and then we never end up signing them. Now, I don't know whether there is any chance of Tanganga signing permanently. I would say there's probably more chance of Tanganga signing permanently than Obafemi. But Millwall, if you're listening to this and there's any way of signing Tango permanently, even if you've got to break your transfer record and spend $3-4 million, if there's a way of doing that, I think you'll get return on investment there. I think he has got the capabilities of being a top centre-half. And since Harris has come in, it's really interesting because I think he's been better under Harris than under Edwards. I know, and that's me taking out the defensive errors that he's made. I think what Harris has done is just said to Tango and to Cooper, just be good defenders. Don't worry about trying to carry the ball out. And I'm not saying that Tanganga can't do it, but I think he is an excellent defender. An excellent defender. And you're seeing that because Harris is just asking him to defend. And he's post-match, he alluded to this, Tanganga, because he talked about, you know, Harris has just said, don't complicate it, keep it simple and just defend. And he's a Rolls Royce of a defender at this level, being a defender. And as I say, if we can break the bank to sign him, I think he's been outstanding. And there we go. The final thing I want to say just before closing out on this is that it's just a thank you to Neil Harris. Honestly, it's the job's not done, Personally, I think we probably need 3 more wins out of 9. You know, maybe even 7 points would be enough. You know, it's very rare teams go down with 50 points. I don't know if anyone's ever gone down with 50 points, to be fair. But say 3 more wins seals it. Rotherham, we should be going there and winning. I think, you know, they'll be well relegated by then. We've got Plymouth at home. We should be winning that game. And if we can win another home game, you know, whether that is West Brom, whether that's Leicester, you know, whoever, just we should be able, in the way we're playing at the minute, to just to be confident to pick one more win at home. That should see us through. The job is not done. But make no mistake about it, we were going down without Neil Harris. And Harris, in such a short space of time, as just, honestly, I look forward to going to the Den. And I don't care it's not pretty, but I know all the players out there are giving absolutely everything to try and win the game. And I just want to say thank you to Neil Harris, because if he does keep us up, personally for me, he's not the right long-term answer. I think he should be involved in the club in some capacity, but he should be built a statue. And I'm not exaggerating. If he has given so much to this club over various stints, and if he can keep us up, to me, that solidifies his legacy. And he goes down as one of, if not the greatest of all time, to ever be involved in this club. And yeah, again, all right, I'm only in my mid-30s, so maybe I haven't seen certain other players, but from my perspective, that's where he is. He got an SOS call from the club, and at the minute, he's fulfilling his duties. And I'm sure that the Berylson family will be very delighted with what he's achieved so far. And to finish off, he's the perfect man to take us up to Leeds. I still remember seeing the video of where he starts the fuck them all away at Leeds when we got in the playoff final. But he is the right man and right character to take us there. And I actually now look forward to watching it. I won't be doing a post-match because I'm actually on holiday. So there won't be a post-match next week. So I've gone a little bit longer this time. But as always, thank you ever so much for listening. I really do appreciate it. Please like, comment, subscribe, all that kind of stuff. And looking forward to seeing you down the Den. It's going to be a long time before the West Brom game, but looking forward to being back down there. It's starting to feel like the Den of old, isn't it? Onwards and upwards. Thanks again for listening. Enjoy the rest of your weekend. Bye for now.